Hi, this is David Wong. I'm going to explain in that video what is GCM. So for example, when you hear AES-GCM, there is always this GCM part. It's a mode of operation, but it brings way more than the usual mode of operation. And I'm going to explain to you exactly what I understood of it. So GCM stands for Galois Counter Mode. So let's start from the beginning. Do you know what is a mode of operation? And I hope you know, because I'm gonna go very briefly over it. So imagine you have a plain text. Here's our plain text. You want to encrypt that. For example, you want to encrypt that with AES, and you will use the key K. And your plain text is 128 bits. So that's the size of AES, the block size of AES. And that gives you your ciphertext. What happens when you want to encrypt something that is bigger than 128 bits? Well, you need a padding system and a mode of operation. So the most simple mode of operation, when you have, like, for example, plaintext 1, plaintext 2, that is two 128 bits block. So for example, you have a long plaintext here. You just cut it in half and you just encrypt the two halves separately. And you just encrypt them like that with the same key. So that's ECB, right? And it gives you ciphertext 1 and ciphertext 2. This is the most simple mode of operation. Never use that. It has a lot of issues. For example, if you encrypt twice the same thing, it will encrypt to the same ciphertext, and you can do frequencies attacks, and there are a lot of issues with that. Never use ECB. So what you can use is, for example, counter mode. So in Galois counter mode, in GCM, you have this counter mode part, and that's why I'm going to explain that first. So counter mode is, instead of encrypting your plaintext, what you do is you encrypt the counter. For example, 1, 2, and so it's different every time. You also want to generate an IV and concatenate that to your counter. So you want to make your IV totally random, and the fact that you will have a counter will encrypt something different every time, so you won't have the same issues as ECB. And right after encryption, you will add your plaintext and you will XOR it with the output of the encryption, and that will give you the plaintext. So that is counter mode. Pretty easy. All right, so that's counter mode. That is also called CTR, and that's the CM in GCM. So when Alice wants to send something to Bob, she will encrypt with her mode of operation a message aim, so that will give her a ciphertext, right? She sends the ciphertext to Bob, and Bob can decrypt the ciphertext with the same key, using the same key to the message. But here, one thing that is important is that what if Charles intercept the message and the ciphertext and decide to flip bits in the ciphertext? So here you can see that if Charles flip the bit here in the ciphertext, Bob will receive the ciphertext and decrypt the ciphertext, and the plain text will have been modified. And here could be the amount in dollars of a transaction, I don't know, it could be important. So what we want when we send something is that nobody can be able to modify the ciphertext, especially the plain text. So what we could do is protect the integrity of the ciphertext, that's how we say it, and we could hash the ciphertext and send that along with the ciphertext. And that's kind of stupid, because Charles can change the ciphertext, rehash the ciphertext, and send that along with the ciphertext also. So no hash. What we want is integrity and authentication. We want to prove to Bob that we hashed the ciphertext. We're sending that hash. So that's called a MAC, and it usually needs a key as well. For simplicity, we can use the same key. Usually you would want to use a different key, but let's just use the same key for now, and you compute the MAC over the ciphertext, and you would then send that MAC along with B, so let's call that MAC MAC. And Bob here would first compute the MAC because Bob would own the key K, right? So he could compute the MAC over the ciphertext. He would get exactly the same thing, so that would tell him nobody changed the ciphertext, and he could decrypt the ciphertext. And this is because it's impossible to spoof a MAC, right? If somebody changed the ciphertext, since he doesn't have the key, he cannot compute the same MAC, the correct MAC on the ciphertext. Okay. So, and usually when you use, for example, a mode of operation like counter mode that use an IV part, you would want to do the MAC over the ciphertext and the IV also. Don't forget to authenticate the IV. All right, so I told you about the MAC part. What I want to tell you is about the Galois MAC. I actually don't know if the real name is the Galois MAC, but that's what is in this G part. So, here, if you want to compute the MAC, the Galois MAC, over this ciphertext, we take the first ciphertext. We give it to an operation that we call multiplication with our, and this time let's use the second key, okay? With our key K2. And this multiplication is actually multiplication is in a special field. That is the Galois field of 2 to the power 128. And I will explain later what is that. So don't worry about that. But basically, let's take that as an encryption. And you take that output, you XOR it with the second part of the ciphertext. You put it back in that multiplication. And it's not finished. What you want to do is also authenticate the length of the ciphertext. So you take the length of the ciphertext, and let's remove that part, and you XOR it as well, and you put it back into the same multiplication one last time, and then you have your MAC. All right, and so that's how you do a MAC over ciphertext, especially in particular the Galois MAC. So let's talk about the GCM. GCM is a mode of operation that brings encryption, right, like counter mode, and authentication. So what it does is that it encrypts for you and computes a MAC for you as well. And this is not finished. I'm going to explain exactly what is GCM, but that's the idea. GCM is brings more than encryption. It brings authenticated encryption. So it's not finished, because here I told you we want to authenticate the IV because we're using a mode of operation that has an IV, counter mode. So what we do, and that's why I didn't start with zero here, is that we will encrypt IV appended to zero with the same key. And actually, let's call it key K. Let's give it the real name because the second key is called H. If you want to look at the specification, and that will be important, because H is actually the encryption with a key, our key K of zero, of the cipher, the plain text composed of 128 bits all set to zero. So we can write it like that. And that's our second key H, and the MAC is actually called a tag. But let's go back here. So we computed the IV appended to zero, the encryption of that with the same key K, and we bring it here, and we XOR it, and we want to add a multiplication here one last time. And also, that is not enough. We want to, that's enough. That's enough. And that's how you get your authenticated encryption of GCM. You authenticate the IV, you authenticate the ciphertext, and you authenticate the length of the ciphertext. And actually, this is not everything, because GCM doesn't bring you only authenticated encryption. It actually brings you authenticated encryption and additional data. And I'm actually not sure the additional data is here. Maybe it's AEAD or AEAD, it doesn't matter. What matters is that Alice is sending something to Bob, for example over the internet, and there are some stuff that she cannot encrypt, but she still wants to authenticate. So for example, we saw the, for example, when Alice sends a packet to Bob on the internet, she will have the payload. So the payload is her message that she encrypts, and she will have some unencrypted stuff, like for example, her IP, her source port, or the IP of Bob, the destination port of Bob, all that kind of stuff that appears in a packet, maybe a packet number. And she wants to authenticate that. And what she can do when she uses GCM is authenticate that here, because GCM is more than authenticated encryption. It's authenticated encryption with additional data. So what we do is we take the additional data and we bring it inside the chain of the MAC. So we multiply it with H in our field, we put it back here, and we XOR that with the first ciphertext. And here it's into the chain of the MAC. Don't forget to authenticate also its length that you append to a ciphertext here. And you get a MAC that is nicely authenticating the IV, authenticating the length of your ciphertext, and authenticating the length of your additional data and your additional data. And that is what is GCM. All right. So one last thing I have to explain to you is how you do that multiplication in the Galois field or finite field to the power 128. So if you don't know what is a field, if you don't know what is a group, multiplicative group and stuff like that, maybe you should look on Wikipedia first, because I'm gonna be kind of fast in my explanations here. So that finite field is actually the additive group 2, so which is 0 and 1, right? Over, so if I remember correctly, is x to the power 128 plus x7 plus x2 plus x plus 1, right? Because any irreducible polynomial finishes by 1. Anyway. So when you want to compute the multiplication of your ciphertext here with H, so H is our second key, and if you remember correctly, H is equal to the encryption of 0, the block 0. So what you do is that you convert first your ciphertext number 1, let's say, to a polynomial. So this field is all the polynomials that are smaller than this and that have characteristic this group characteristic 2. So for example 1 0 1 x plus 1 x x square plus 1 x square, etc. Okay, and the multiplication in this group is exactly the same set of elements, except you don't have 0. Alright, so when you want to do that multiplication here, you transform your ciphertext, and your ciphertext is actually numbers, right? Ones, binary numbers, 1, 0, 0, 1, blah, 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 blah. So you take the smallest one, and if it's a 1, then it's 1. You take the second one, and if it's a 1, then it's plus x. The third one, if it's 0, it's 0 times x squared, which is nothing, etc., etc. So for example, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1 would translate to 1 plus x squared plus x to the power 4. And you do the same thing with h, so you get the multiplication of two polynomials. For example, h is, I don't know, x5 plus x. And you calculate that thing and you translate it back to 1 and zeros. And that's how you do a multiplication in that field. What happens, just one last thing, and I think that will be everything. What happens when you get, like for example, very big numbers and you get something like x to the power 129, and that's over that polynomial, that's bigger than that polynomial. What happens is that you have to reduce that polynomial to that one. So we have in this field we have this equality, which is that that polynomial is equals to zero. And what you can do to find the value of that polynomial is that you can multiply by x everything here. And that will give you this equation. X squared plus x equals zero, and you transfer everything to the other side. Since we're in characteristic two, there will be no minus, and it will be equal to this number. And that's how you get bigger polynomials, the value of bigger polynomials in that kind of field. So I think that is everything. I don't know what to add more. If you have any questions, you can always ask me. I'll be glad to answer. And you can follow me on Twitter or check my blog, cryptology.net. And stay tuned for the next video. If you have any ideas, you can always ask me. Cheers.